Hi, welcome back to Projects with Everyday Dave. I have some really cool results to show you today. I went ahead and installed this southwest facing array based on your comments and our analysis from the last video I did, which showed the results of my west facing array versus my south facing array during the winter. And I've been trying to spread out the input into my inverter across the day a little bit more to maximize the performance. But what we saw in the winter results was, since the sun is rising in the southeast and setting in the southwest, by the time it came around to hit these west-facing panels, it was already setting, and so we got very little performance out of them. Now, you're gonna see today that this southwest-facing array gets much better results. Now, these are mid-year results, so halfway between the summer and winter solstice, so I don't know exactly what it will get in winter. I'll go ahead and run it year-round, and we'll find out come winter time what it is, but I think we can determine from this that this is a much better solution. In the process of creating all of these test fixtures, I have this one, that west-facing one, and I have another one over by the house that I'm using to evaluate different types of panels as well as microinverters from NEP, which has some really good results. I'll bring those to you later. One solution I found that works really great is these mini rails from K2 Systems. And in fact, I'm using K2 Systems on my friend's shop roof install, which is almost finished. I'll be bringing that to you soon. Hit the notification bell so you know when it comes out. These mini rail systems are great for the small DIY as well as large systems. They're much easier to ship. You don't have these giant rails to work with. And they're designed with these rubber backings so that you can put them on a steel roof and they seal off. But you can use them for a lot of other things. I make wood fixtures and then mount them to the wood with a few screws, and they're clamp system is self-bonding, so you don't have to have extra grounding systems. You can expand them, you can make them any size you want, you can add more later. I even cut these in half sometimes so that I have more mounts to put places. You can mount right to the side of a building. I'll put a link below if you want to try them out. They work great. All right, I've got some really neat results, so let's get into the numbers. Okay, just a real quick reminder on clipping here before we get into the numbers. My solar array can put out more than 9 kilowatts of power, but my inverter is limited to 7.6 kilowatts max. So on a bright sunny day, like this January 31st day that's mapped out here, each individual solar panel puts out a nice smooth curve, but when you stack them all up, at the middle of the day, they get clipped off here at the top, and that's because the inverter can't quite put out that much. So one of the things that we were trying to do is expand the array's output further out into the evening and into the morning to take advantage of more of the day's sunlight without clipping it off in the middle of the day. So I got a lot of comments on the last video. Why don't you just get a bigger inverter? Well, it doesn't make sense to get a bigger inverter when more than 20 of the days in my particular area in January don't have any clipping at all. There's actually only 6 days that have maximum clipping, and a few days with a little bit of clipping. It doesn't make sense to spend a lot of money on an inverter that can achieve the total output capacity of your array. So the way to build a system to get the quickest payback is to have some oversizing. If you watched my winter results, you saw the results from putting this west array in, and we had a pretty poor result. These panels only put out 52% of the power that was put out in the west-facing array. And if you look at the graph that we did prove the theory that angling panels towards the east and west would increase our output later in the day. However, the rest of the day's output was so poor that it just didn't make sense. A panel facing purely south would have been a better contribution than this west-facing panel, at least during the winter solstice. And you can see that here from our outside the range clipping data that I showed in the winter video. We do get a little bit more power in the afternoon, but it produces so little power in the morning that it cancels out. And overall, it was a loss to put a panel facing west. So it just didn't make sense to do it that way. Well, looking at that data and seeing all your comments, my next plan was to add a panel facing southwest. And so that's this panel that you see here. It faces southwest. I wasn't able to put in several panels because there just wasn't room, but the data is pretty clear. I think the one panel is enough information for us to draw some conclusions from that. This data represents a whole day's production, and you can ignore these panels in the middle. I had to unplug them to keep the inverter from clipping so that I would make sure and get the full power output of the remaining panels. These represent the panels to the west. This is the southwest, and then this panel here is the most representative of the south-facing panels. It's the exact same
Jinko Solar used panel I got from Santan that I have applied for both of these arrays. So they're apples to apples comparison. Now, right off the bat, you can see that the production dramatically improved, even for the West array, from a 52% output to a 75% output, which is really a lot better, but it's still nowhere near the output that the South one gets. Now, what's really cool is the Southwest array is 92% of the output that the South array was able to achieve. Now, this wasn't exactly at the equinox being the middle point between the summer and winter solstice. The equinox is March 22nd, but the first fully sunny day I could get was April 4th, and that's within about 4 degrees of the equinox, so I think these results pretty well represent the middle of the year. Now, when we graph it out, you can really clearly see what's going on. The South array has this perfectly normal curve here. This is actual data. And the Southwest array has almost exactly the same shape, just shifted off center because it's tilted towards the west. And the fall off in the afternoon is steeper. You can see the west facing array is a little bit more gradual, which is what gives us this improved performance in the afternoon, which is exactly what we're looking for. And that 92% of the output is because it's just not quite as tall, but it's giving us output during the afternoon when we want it. And you can see this west-facing array still is underperforming. In fact, it doesn't do any better in the late evening than the southwest array, but significantly worse here earlier in the day. The whole output is much less. So at least for this mid-year result, it's very clear that the southwest array is a significant improvement over pure west. So let's take these individual panel results and I'll multiply them across the entire array, and I'll symmetry the west results about the solar noon to simulate what we would have if we had some facing east, southeast, and west, southwest. Okay, so let's first look at the base condition, which would be all panels facing south. That would be 30 panels, which is the maximum number of panels that this 7.6 kilowatt inverter can handle. Different inverters can handle different quantities, but that's what I'm working with here. This is all panels facing south. You can see we get a pretty significant amount of clipping here during the middle of the day. And our output is 65.9 kilowatt hours. And the power ratio, or the available power to usable power, is 152%. So what happens when we look at the west and east? This data here is the west facing panels, and then I symmetried that about solar noon to get the equivalent east facing. So if I made the array such that 15 panels were facing east and 15 panels were facing west, we would get 60.3 kilowatt hours, which is a 9% reduction from everything facing south. And it's a little easier to see here if I stack one on top of the other. We do achieve the one goal of reducing clipping, and in fact, there is no clipping in this situation. Here's a power ratio of 152%, meaning the number of panels that are out there is 152% of what the inverter is rated for, but there's no clipping. So there is another situation where you would want to significantly oversize your inverter because you have panels facing in two different directions and they will never clip. So you can use a much smaller inverter and get a lot more power out of it. Now, in this case, we're not achieving our goal because we actually are producing less power with this scenario. And, you know, as you saw from the beginning, that's because the sun just isn't intense enough in at this time of year to hit those east and west facing panels. So our production drops to 60.3 kilowatts. So that's not what we want to do. Now, we could improve that by putting four more panels into the array. We get a very small amount of clipping, and we would actually equal the output of a fully south facing array. But we did have to add panels to do that, and actually this inverter can't handle 34 panels, so it wouldn't really work. But if you had an inverter that could handle that, that would be a solution. You'd have very little clipping, a nice broad curve of power from morning to evening. So that's a solution that you might consider if you're trying to get the most broad power output throughout the day as possible. But that's not what I'm trying to do. I'm trying to maximize my output. Now, you can see here with the output from the southeast, we get a much taller curve And that's because it almost has the same output as the south array. And you can see them kind of overlapped here. If I stack them on top of each other, you see we do get some clipping, but we get some pretty good broad shoulders as well. Even though these put out slightly less power, the overall result is 2% more than a south-facing array. And that's because we have this improved output in the shoulders, even though there's a little less output in the middle of the day. So not only are we getting power during a larger portion of the day, but we've reduced the load on the inverter with less clipping, and we've increased the total power output for the array up to 67.2 instead of 65.9. So this is exactly what we were trying to do, and we just needed to face the panels a little bit more south to achieve it. Now, if I overlay all three together so you can see how they stack up, you can see the east-west facing array has no clipping. It has good shoulders, but even though we improve the output in the early morning and in the afternoon, we lose so much in the middle of the day that it comes out as a loss. And then the southwest, southeast facing, we reduce the amount of clipping in the day, which ends up giving us a little bit of loss, but we improve the performance so much in the evening and the morning that it overcomes that, and the overall result is actually more output. So we get more output and a smoother output throughout more of the day. So this is a much better result. All right, let's take a quick look at why we got the results we did. In this image, you can see the impact of solar declination, which is the angle of the sun relative to the Earth. So the Earth rotates, you can kind of see in this animation here. As the Earth rotates about its axis and moves around the sun, it has the effect of tilting back and forth towards the sun. And so that's what gives you the short days in the winter and the long days in the summer. Now, one of the sites that I used for this solar analysis is pveducation.org. It's a great site if you want to dig into all the details about how the sun rises and sets and how it impacts exactly where you live. But the results I'm going to show you here are going to be pretty similar no matter where you are on the globe, unless you're really far north or south. So the data that I took for this mid-year result was very close to the equinox. The equinox is actually March 22nd, but I couldn't get a fully sunny day until April 4th, but it's within 4 or 5 degrees. So on this chart, you can see east and west is 90 and 270 degrees, and north would be at zero, and south would be at 180 degrees. So I'm in the northern hemisphere, so the sun rises and sets across the southern part of this chart. Now, this particular line is the March 22nd equinox, and you can see the sun rises and sets almost due east and due west. And so that's why we got the results we did, as opposed to in the winter, where the sun is rising much further to the south. So I've plotted both lines here. You can see with the summer solstice line, sun is rising 30 degrees north of due east. And I've marked these little green dots on here to represent when the sun is 10 degrees above the horizon. This axis from the center all the way out to the outside is how high in the sky the sun is, the elevation of the sun. So this outer border would be right at the horizon, 0 degrees elevation. And then this first ring would be 10 degrees up. And what I found is the solar panels really don't pick up much power at all until the sun's about 10 degrees off the horizon, at least where I live. If you're in an area with mountains, it might even be much higher than that. When I start looking at the angles that I want to consider my panels at, I consider them for the sunrise and sunset at 10 degrees off the horizon. And this is the winter solstice line, and this is the summer solstice line. The data we took today was the line right in between here, which would be the equinox. If we take our azimuth data at 10 degree elevation, then the angles that we want to deal with are the sun rising 20 degrees north of due east and the sun rising 43 degrees south of due east. And that's the range in which I want to make sure my panels are capturing light. Now, it's a little bit easier to visualize with this map here, and I've plotted the winter solstice and the summer solstice. In the winter, 43 degrees back from 90 here is where the sun angles are going to rise and set against my array. And in the summer, you don't get to take advantage of the sun rising and setting late because it's hitting the back of the panels. Now, I did put in some bifacial panels, and we'll see if that picks some of that up, but we don't have those results yet. Based on that analysis, I want to have my panels capturing as much of the winter sun as possible without losing any of the summer sun. With my irradiance meter, I've been mapping when the panels pick up the most power, and I guess it's common sense, but when the sun is directly hitting the panels, even if it's significantly off angle, you have way more power than when it's just ambient light. I mean, it's significantly different. Based on today's results, I think it's pretty clear that we want to have our panels slightly angled off of due south, kind of in a V shape, but as close to south as possible without missing our summer sun. So I'm thinking I'm going to try another angle at about 20 degrees. 20 degrees will keep all of the sunlight hitting the panels up until the sun's about 10 degrees off the horizon, even at the summer solstice, but it'll still be facing mostly south, so in the winter we don't lose too much power. So that's why we got the results we have, and why I'm thinking even a little bit less angle will give us even a better result. So if I have time, I will build yet another fixture with more angles on it, hopefully before the summer solstice, so I can get from July all the way to January again with more angles, and we'll see if this analysis proves out. So in conclusion here, what do you want to take away from this? Here's the reality. No matter where you are, you're going to have this similar impact of longer days in the summer, shorter days in the winter. So how do you make the best use of that? Well, part of it's going to depend on your situation. If you are in an off-grid situation and you need to have a lot of power in the morning or in the evening, you can see now how you would want to tilt your panels to achieve that. Probably not due east and due west, unless you're trying to get all of your power in the very middle of summer. But if you need most of your power in the winter, you're going to want to bias that probably due south, maybe a slight tilt, but most likely due south with a pretty steep tilt. And if you want to get some kind of good balance between all of those, then put a slight V in your array, just maybe 20 degrees off of due south on each side. And I think you'll get a little bit better result than what I have here. This was 45 degrees off, and probably in the winter, we're going to suffer a little bit, although it's probably going to be pretty good in the summer. So adding the east-west panels resulted in less clipping, actually more power. It is going to make racking a little bit more difficult, so if that's a thing for you, that's something to consider. And I don't know yet what the winter output will be for these additional angles, but I'll probably add some more angles and gather more data and bring that to you later on in the year. So there's always more to check.
If all of this seems like too much work or you just don't have time to do it, I've got a great free solution for you, and that's EnergyPal. They're not beholden to any one supplier or any one manufacturer. They really are working just for you to help you find the best solution that's going to work for your place. And they will help you understand if it even makes sense. So they aren't going to try and sell you something that you don't need. Not only that, if you use the link in the description below and you end up installing a system through them, you get a $500 gift card. It's really nice to have an advocate on your side instead of trying to rely on whoever's selling you a particular system that you may or may not need. One of the customers I talked to said that one of the best things about having EnergyPal on her side was if there was a delay or she didn't understand something, she could call EnergyPal. They could talk to the supplier directly or help her solve the problem, and she wasn't left trying to solve it on her own. So what do you have to lose? Cost you nothing, you could get 500 bucks in the end. Go ahead and check them out. Otherwise, stick around and you can learn how to not repeat all the mistakes I made on your system. So good luck on your install. I'll see you next time.